It's an awesome shirt, by the way. Those guys are super bros.
Thanks, man. Yeah, I picked it up when I saw him with Dillinger on the last tour they did with Carbomb.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Fuck. I've never got to see Carbomb. They're cool, though.
It was definitely good. I just feel like since it was like towards the end of everything, the end of the tour and shit, they were just kind of burnt out. Mm-hmm. But I mean, the quality of the music was definitely awesome. They just seemed tired.
Was that the farewell tour?
Yeah. I think it was like last month or something.
All right. Yeah. Ready, Nick?
Yeah.
I'm wearing a shirt that you'd really appreciate.
Oh yeah, what are you wearing?
It's a NASA shirt.
All right. You, sir, are I'll let you know.
Okay.
Any minute now. You're good.
We're live?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, sorry about that, everybody. Evidently the stream was just unbearable, and I heard it was like you were time traveling forward in time, but only 5 seconds at a time or something like that. So we're going to just start it over. I'm here with Tony and Josh of Live by Mistake. And so far, we really haven't covered much. We just covered the fact that studio magic happens. And so where are you guys from?
I'm from here, St. Charles, Missouri, actually right down the street from where I'm currently residing. So, yeah, St. Charles.
Yeah, same. I'm in St. Louis, but I was born and raised here.
Right on. Yeah, I'm from Florida. Nothing really awesome happens out here anymore.
Gainesville is cool.
Yeah, when Fest is around, usually, but now Fest is all just like pop punk, and that's not really my cup of tea.
Yeah, do they kind of do like offshoot shows from that though too?
Yeah, actually, the shows that you really want to see when you go to Fest are not like the Fest shows at all. It's usually shows that people do at like their houses or, you know, just random other shit that goes on out there. But anyway, so we covered that your guys' favorite tour was the tour with Between the Buried and Me.
Yeah, that one was good. We also did a tour with Tony Danza and Psyopus that was really memorable. Pretty much because
the Psyopus that one for me is, that was 3 months long.
what was that? That was like right after, so I broke up with this girl I was with for like 7 years, and I was like, fuck it, we're just gonna do this thing. And I booked this for 3 months straight. We all hated each other, I think, within the first month. But
how was it touring with Psyopus?
Well, there was never a dull moment.
Yeah, we never really did a lot with them in a row, though. We just did a show here or there or something like that, wasn't it?
Yeah, I think when I was singing for Tony Danza, we did a whole West Coast tour with them.
Yeah, so we didn't technically. You did with Tony Danza. We played shows here and there, but we never did.
But we did a West Coast sprint with them, and you know, it was when Chris Ark was still super hyper. I think he's chilled out a little bit more now.
He's definitely still super hyper, man.
Yeah.
We actually just did an interview with him like probably a month or so ago. And, dude, I didn't have to say a word the entire interview.
You just let him go.
He was just going.
As a whole, that band was as crazy as they sounded.
Yeah. I actually told him, I was like, man, if... I was like, I've never met anyone whose playing style, like, reciprocates how you are in real life. Like, he's like, just as spastic as, you know, when seeing fucking... Psyopus, or how he plays, it's crazy.
Yeah. So I think it was the really cool thing was because we were touring when they still had the original singer. So it was him and King Augie. And like Augie was, I don't know. I'd be surprised if that guy's still alive. But I mean, he would be like, hey, man, look at this. And like you look down and you have a turd in his hand. He's like, yeah, turds. And like, He was just constantly like bleeding and puking and then eating blood and puke. And I mean, it was fun to see. I wouldn't want him to live in my house or anything, but
you wouldn't want anything less from him, really.
Yeah. I wouldn't let him cook me a dinner.
So, I don't think we covered your, the bands that you've been in the past. So besides, Lie by Mistake, obviously, what have you guys done?
Go ahead, Tony.
Oh, it's all right. Go ahead.
I moved out to Montana for a number of years, and when I was there, I played like in a cover band, and then I was just on the road a lot until I came back. So I didn't play with anybody, and certainly nobody in the area, you know. So I just listened to a lot of music.
Yeah.
Preparing, I guess. I played cover band. I played in bands in high school like crazy, and then after high school, I was just done. Didn't play until later on.
Yeah, actually, so kind of the same thing. We just did a bunch of local metal bands. Nothing really had that much esteem.
You said that you did.
I mentioned Danza. So pretty much Jesse Danza at the time and the band weren't working out. And actually, the song Go Greyhound is about this. And they pretty much had all they could handle with them. Threw him a fucking Greyhound bus ticket and flew me out. And then I sang for him for about 4 months. And then, you know, I handed the torch back to Jesse. Pretty much told him, you know, the end of it all. He goes, give me some advice. What should I do, you know? And I said, don't fuck up again because I'll take it, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, compared to the shit that we had to do with Lie by Mistake and all the fucking work and everything, just to get in a van and show up and play and not have to worry about shit, like, it was a cakewalk, you know? And plus, those guys are also fucking really good people that I still talk to. Well, yeah, on and off. It's weird, actually. So, Danza's actually almost more of a St. Louis band now than anything. Our buddy Josh Travis and Phil, I think even the drummer that, I mean, now they're Muir, but that originally pretty much them and Jesse was Tony Danza for the last two albums. So. Yeah.
There's an Adam in the comments that says King Augie was me and I'm still alive. I love you. Ha ha ha.
Did he really fucking say that?
Yeah. So I guess King Augie is alive. And he
was. Oh shit, that's Adam. That's rad.
And it says Timothy asked, wasn't the Alpha Omega just the singer and guitarist? I don't really know what he's referencing, but
I have no idea.
Like I said, I'm learning a lot about the bands that I'm interviewing because all I've ever known, I've always looked up to the music, you know what I mean? And I've always had the music and that's all I've listened to. I've never like researched any of the people who created any of this shit, you know? And so it's like every time I interview someone, they're like just now, I just learned that you were doing vocals for Tony Danza. And I've loved Tony Danza. And that's just something I never would have known unless, you know, I would be doing these interviews. So that's why I have people like my buddy who writes me all my questions and shit, because, you know, I didn't know much about anybody. I just, right. And he ran a fucking like a mathcore blog. So he just fucking has like all the knowledge in the world about all these people. And he's just like, he'll send me a Facebook link and he'll be like, get this dude because they were in this, this, and this. And or he knows what music I actually have liked or whatever. Yeah. And he'll help me out. So, I mean, it's, I do have to say, it's really awesome to be able to, you know, put a face with thing about the people that I've, you know, looked up to musically for so long.
It's rad.
But, so a lot of people who watch, they are mostly interested in like tour stories or just, you know, like, and most of the stories that we've heard are just, you know, people sticking a liquor bottle up their ass or people shitting or, you know, whatnot, et cetera. So, I mean, do you guys have any tales of anything that happened to you guys personally?
Josh has got one.
Oh, no. That's not good. Yeah, I don't limitations.
Know. We're fine. You know.
I don't know. I almost killed myself once accidentally. I fell through a ceiling. It was a theater, but the balcony was blocked off, and there was just a drop ceiling put there. So, I'm just being kind of stupid. I was messing around and up in the balcony part, and ended up falling through. And yeah, fucked myself up pretty good. There's more to it, but I don't know why I ended up falling through and all that. But yeah, not a very good story. It was good. I mean, when you're there, you know, it was pretty rough. I got to spend the night in the hospital, though. That was pretty cool because I got morphine and I had a comfortable shower. All the other guys, stay in the van or whatever the fuck it was, like usual. So,
did you guys have any issue with the police ever on the road?
Just really just shutting down shows in Houston. Yeah. We played this like
weird warehouse. Baton Rouge. They.
Oh yeah, they almost broke up on that day.
Like something out of the. Shut down the show and then took the money and then just killed everybody. Split.
Well, that happened too. We played DC. It was Genghis Tron's second show ever. We played with him in DC and the cops stole the door money. They didn't bother shutting down the show. They just fucking came in and took the door money and took off.
That's fucking crazy. Yeah.
I'm
trying to get somebody from Genghis Tron on the show right now.
I
would love to talk with them. Like, shit, I think I saw Genghis Tron at Skate Park of Tampa, like, fucking 2004, maybe, or something like that. It was a long motherfucking time ago. But, yeah, that's another one of my co-hosts. It's, like, one of his favorite bands as well. I would definitely love to get them on. So, how did the band members get their nicknames?
Oh, the nicknames?
Yeah.
Fuck.
Titanium, hell. Tony, Max Tempo, Johnny Pocket, Ben Whalen.
I think it all started with Drew, our drummer. Because, I don't know, he just always was going, you know?
Yeah.
And he would have this, like, alter ego that was just, ended up being the most annoying thing in the fucking world. But, and it would be Max Tempo. And originally we called him Max Tempo because he would just speed up while we were playing live, and it's like, you know, shit's hard enough, you know? And it just kind of caught on, and he would just be like this little, I don't know, like a menace pretty much.
And that was well, once he took on the alter ego and the Max Tempo, then of course, I think Johnny Pocket, obviously Bassman, and he's in the pocket. I think Drew came up with the names. I know I didn't have anything to do with whatever I was. Then I assume Drew came up with those.
Yeah, because
I'll be right.
Another question from Keith is, where can I find the 3-song demo Fee Jar with Tony on vocals?
Oh shit!
Like I told you, he does some fucking digging, man.
Oh man, that's a good question. You know, I think Adam has that bomber.
Really?
He's listening.
I had it, and my wife took my MacBook in the divorce, so it's on there.
I think
I also didn't tell Josh about the divorce.
I have to.
What?
I'll have to. You know, I should know that. I think I have a copy somewhere, but hell, if I know,
it exists somewhere.
10 years since I listed it, almost probably the.
I think it's actually on a Google Drive I have. I can probably dig it up.
Right on. Well, there's at least one person who would be interested in hearing that. So there was a rumor about Lie and Look What I Did exchanging members on tour playing each other's songs. Any truth in that?
No.
No?
The only thing we exchanged was spit. We did have a really cool show with them. We played on this Marine base one time, and with Look What I Did, and it was right around the time where they were getting dropped by Combat Records because Combat became just a house for Horse the Band solely.
Yeah.
And there's this little 16-year-old kid, and he's talking to the Look What I Did kids, and he's like, man, that really sucks, like, combat's bullshit, blah, blah, blah. And these two drunk Marines fucking hear him saying combat's bullshit, and they took it as, like, a fucking, like, oh, this guy is fucking anti-American shit, and these two fucking jacked out fucking jocks try to beat up this kid, and I fucking get in between them, I'm holding the guy down, and the dude's like, get off my bro, bro, get off my bro, get off my bro. And I looked at him like, shut up or fucking hit me. Like, let's fucking do this, you know? And like, so the Look What I Did kids are like fucking running around. All the rest of the Live My Mistakes, like, inside. And all they hear is like, Tony's fucking trying to fight this guy. They come outside. They're like, what the fuck are you doing? I'm like, I'm going to kill this motherfucker. That's what I'm doing. I'm going to curb stop this piece of shit. And Josh grabs me and he's just like, dude, you need to calm the fuck down. I'm like, and no one knew what, like, no one really knew what the fuck was going on. All they knew is I wanted to smash this dude. And the funniest thing was, the whole band thought I was just fucking losing my mind and trying to fight these bros. I was like trying to protect this kid that was like fucking a buck of a five, you know?
That's usually how it happens, man.
Yeah.
So
those guys are really cool. That was the only time on that tour. That was the only time I ever played a show high.
Yeah.
I think Jake smoked me out before we played one time.
Yeah, I like those guys quite a bit. That was a good one.
I could definitely never do that. When I was in bands, I did vocals, and I just could never play high. I never had any energy or anything. I would always just be a fucking slug. I'd just be a potato.
It was awesome, because like, anytime I was playing keyboards, it was like, this is the coolest fucking thing in the world. And then whenever I sing, I was like, why am I so mad?
Yeah, I was just a big drunk, and whenever I would play drunk, it would just intensify everything, because I'd be violent, I suppose. Mm-hmm. And most of the violence actually fell more on my friends than any like people who were just at our show or whatever, because my tattoo artist, actually, he was at one of our first shows, the band that actually all three of my coaches were in fucking around probably fucking 10 years ago. My tattoo artist, he just told me this story the other day. He's like, man, I remember fucking seeing you guys, and I ran up to the stage to sing along with you guys, and you just fucking fireman kicked me right in the chest as hard as you fucking could. And, you know, I'm a larger dude. I'm like fucking 260 pounds, and I fucking kicked this fucking little, he must have been fucking like a, like you said, like a buck 20, dude. Kicked him right in the fucking chest. He said he couldn't catch his fucking breath for like a week. So yeah, I could never play high. That was just never my thing. Although I did partake quite a bit back then. I would always wait till afterwards, just because I couldn't do it.
Yeah, they always kind of were worried about me when I was interacting with people, because I'd be a little violent and pushy and shovey. And like, I remember John telling me, our bass player, being like, dude, if I ever came to a show and somebody did that to me, I would fucking deck him in the face, you know?
Yeah.
But I don't know.
John kicked somebody real pretty good one time. That was a nice one.
Yeah, well, that kid was, I think North Carolina. And he kept running up to John and trying to play his bass while he was playing it. And John just decked him.
Did you guys ever play Tampa, Florida?
Yeah, we played Ybor with Into the Moat.
Into the Moat. Do you remember who else was on that tour?
Harlots. It was actually their singer had to, he has Crohn's disease.
Yeah.
And he had to go back home for a surgery. And I actually sang for both bands on that.
Was that at the Orpheum? Do you remember?
No, it was like a record shop. It was just a little record shop. It was the day, it was when Suzanne was riding along with us at the time. And, it was just this little tiny record shop. And the only thing really memorable about it was I actually go to Ybor like once a year now anyway to work this repeal day party for bartending. But it was the day the Cardinals won the World Series. Because we played that show, and then I ran to watch the rest of the game.
That's pretty vivid memory of 10 years, an event 10 years ago. So let's see what else Keith has to say here. He says, Do you think if Lie by Mistake stayed together, that you would eventually have shed your metal elements?
depends on, like, you know, if Tony would have stayed in the band, because, you know, that the second album was written for vocals, and, you know, a lot of those metal elements were there because of the vocals.
Yeah.
So it's possible, you know, had you know, Tony left, like, as he did, and then we kept going. But, I mean, we're at least 30% or better through the next album, and we are still keeping it pretty heavy. So it may be, but, you know, we're probably always maintained a certain metal element because that's what people expect, and, you know, to some degree, you know.
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of different dynamics going on with that band, too, where somewhere along the line, like, after I left, Drew became a born-again Christian and just stopped playing fucking metal altogether. Yeah. So, like, there would have been definitely a predicament with that.
Well, yeah. He just wouldn't have been a part of it at all, yeah. Regardless, just the touring and whatever.
So has there ever been any talk or anything of maybe getting together to do, like, a reunion show or anything like that?
No.
That's you know, usually the answer we get.
It's just too much damn work.
Yeah, it would be so much down to. And then we would actually have to find another drummer to play it, because I don't think Drew would do it, you know. And our bass player, Johnny, I mean, he's Houdini, pretty much. He'll be around for 2 weeks, and you won't see him for a month, and he'll be around for 2 weeks, and, you know. So it's just, we're kind of all on our own paths. And
yeah, for sure.
I have been doing a concert series in St. Louis called False Front, and it's pretty much like a cover show. And yeah. I just teamed up with a local band here. Well, actually, they're more regional now, called The Gorge. But we just did a whole botched cover set.
Nice.
I can actually send a link to that because they Facebook Live.
Is that The Gorge?
Yeah. Was rad.
Oh, that's a very good band. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You guys need to check that out if you haven't heard.
They played botch better than botch does.
I don't doubt that.
Yeah.
So we're pretty big into vinyl and stuff over here, and every Wednesday I do a segment called Wax Worship Wednesday, and I'll do a video on YouTube, and I'll review a piece of vinyl out of my, like, collection that I have, like, bought either to review or I just have.
Yeah.
What would you guys say is your favorite album that you own on vinyl?
Code 7. The Rescue. So,
like, an actual vinyl album?
Yes.
I don't know vinyl albums.
Are you familiar with Code 7 at all?
I'm not. I have not heard them.
It's a band on North Carolina. They used to be a hardcore band. They used to tour with a local band called Love Lost But Not Forgotten, which also I played with them for a reunion thing. It was just a benefit for a friend of ours. But pretty much, they start off as, like, this hardcore band. It's three brothers, and they just kind of, like, didn't feel like that was going well for them. They got their guitars, put on MIDI pickups, and just played through synths. And it's this really, like, kind of, like, ethereal Alan Thompson kind of, like, Radiohead-y indie rock kind of thing. But they were really, the singer and I had a lot of different talks about vocal techniques and singing and things like that. And yeah. I was still learning a lot, but that band was really instrumental to me, like, growing up. And, you know, I pretty much worked at venues and bars since I was 16. So those guys meant a lot to me.
So would you do anything in particular to like warm up, or any vocal warm ups or anything like that, tips or tricks?
He would scream.
I would scream.
Yeah.
Scream and stretch.
Yeah, I remember when I was first getting into doing vocals, and I would do just, like, kind of, like, grindy high screams or whatever with my first band, and I would just go into another room and grab a pillow and just fucking scream into it until my voice was just, like, raspy.
Yeah.
And then I'd be like, okay, we're ready to go. And then, like, once I had trained myself to do, like, lows and stuff like that, I remember somebody telling me to drink chocolate milk because it, like, made your throat coated or whatever. Yeah. And then that was always just something I always did because it literally will change the entire tone of your voice almost. Like, it can get, like, those, like, really low, like, cattle decapitation, gurgly, like, yeah. So like a sound like a sink draining or something, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. And get it flummy.
Yeah, for sure.
Flummy.
So where did Lie by Mistake get their name from? Was it from that poem?
Yeah.
Yeah.
The Gashlycrumb Tinies.
Yeah, I was I actually stumbled across that poem one day, and I saw Lie by Mistake in there. And I was just like, I wonder, like, that's kind of a weird name to just pull out of nowhere.
Yeah, it was actually a buddy of mine. He actually works at my bar, still, and he was trying to play with us for a little bit, and it was actually his name, and we just kind of stole it and called it a day. We didn't realize saying it, like, visually it looks cool on paper, but saying it out loud was a total pain in the ass.
There's always an explanation that's kind of required because it sounds kind of silly. But I'd left town for like a couple weeks, and while I was gone, this was probably in the first 6 months or so before I came back, and I was like, all right, I'm committed. I'm going to talk these guys into changing the name before anybody really starts to know it. And then, so I came back into town, and I had a good argument, and then I think the first thing they showed me when I came in was that we'd won, like, best name and so, in like, a local magazine, you know. So it was enough, you know, kind of took the wind out of my sails, so I couldn't say anything about it. So
I wanted to call it Dancer Boy.
Well, I mean, if you say anything enough, it kind of just, like, sounds strange to you, you know what I mean? Like, even with the name of our podcast or whatever, when we started out, we had a couple different names and stuff that were with what our original idea was to be kind of like a Loveline-esque call-in show where, like, people get advice from someone who has no right to give anyone advice. Because I've been, like, newly sober for, like, 7 months and have, like, kind of turned my life around, I guess you could say. I mean, not really much, but I've always kind of been, like, good at giving people advice and not taking my own advice. So we went with the name Sheep's Clothing because, like, you know, wolf in sheep's clothing or whatever. And I remember when I first heard it, I was just like, yeah, you know, that sounds decent or whatever. And then the more I've heard it and the more I've written it down and the more I've made fucking images and shit, I hate the name so much that I just wish I could change it. Right. But, like, everywhere I've gone and read anything about podcasting or anything like that, it's like you have to be fucking consistent with everything, yeah. Or else you're just going to lose all the steam that you've built. So I'm just kind of stuck with it at this point. So, I mean, I can definitely
name on that.
Yeah, it was a pain in the ass, but it did look cool on paper.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, that's probably the reason that I was drawn to it, looking through that giant torrent file. I was like, oh, that looks like an interesting name. And then I forget what the song title was, but it was the first song on the first album that was on there, the one that had vocals on it. It was after I heard that, I was just like, oh, you know, this kind of sounds a lot like Psyopathy. And I was just like, I could get into the fucking, like, guitar tapping and whatnot. And being a vocalist, I was just, like, kind of drawn to the vocals that were on it, and I was just like, you know, this is good shit. So I definitely wore that out. Like, I listened to that shit fucking front to back so many times.
We like.
Yeah. I mean, I now that I have gone this far and all the bands that are on that torrent file that I listen to are just, like, not together anymore, I kind of feel horrible about downloading it and, like, not being able to support them or whatever.
We never would have saw any of that money anyway. You know, especially after we signed to Black Market, we definitely wouldn't have seen a fucking dime.
Yeah, know? See, I've heard a lot of shit about Black Market. Like, I've heard that, you know, they haven't always been fair and shit like that. But if you wrote down every single band that was ever on Black Market and put it on a fucking list, that list would be fucking epic as shit. You know what I mean?
Right. Yeah. That's kind of like where we joined on that side too. But
yeah.
I mean, I can't really say anything bad about the label. I mean, really.
And yeah.
We barely did. We had the, as soon as the album was made, we were pretty much done after that. And we couldn't get it on a decent tour. And that was one of the issues. But I think he tried. And, you know, I still have about 300 CDs they never asked me to pay for. So it's
stuck right in the closet.
Don't know what I'll do with them. But
I have about 300 of the fabulous EPs that we did with Darkfront.
Oh,
if you ever want some of those.
Dude, I usually wait till the end of my interview to even talk about it, but since my intro got cut off from the other fucking
I heard it anyway. We'll definitely mail you some stuff out for sure.
Oh, hell yeah. Yeah, but we're doing a giveaway, and we have basically we're having every single person that we've interviewed. I've asked them about it. I mean, not everybody has agreed, but dude, I have a fucking box sitting over here that I just wish I could just keep it and have everything in it because it's so fucking great. Like, we interviewed the guys from Great Redneck Hope, and I mean, they fucking just shelled out so much shit, dude. Like, they gave me like 2 copies of every vinyl that they put out. They gave me like 2 copies of CDs that they put out. They sent me 2 Worry shirts from their new band that they're in. Stickers and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And then I did an interview with Derek Vascani from A Second Story Window, and he sent me his book that he wrote. Did a reunion interview with the guys from Tower of Rome, and that shit, that was like the first time that those dudes were in the same room for like fucking 10 years, you know?
Yeah.
And I mean, that was huge for me, but they were like, yeah, contact He Who Corrupts. I'm sure they have a pile of shit that nobody wants. And
oh, I guarantee it. That dude's fucking crazy.
Yeah. I was actually talking with him, and he was saying that he wanted to do an interview with us the next time that He Who Corrupts got together, because they were going to do a show in drag called She Who Corrupts. And they're just going to do the whole interview and drag with us. So I'm looking forward to that. That should be interesting.
They'll be red.
Yeah, for sure. So we have some kind of like unorthodox questions that we usually get into around the end of the interview. My co-host Josh usually asks them, but he's off doing his own thing right now, so I'll get into them. They're just kind of like Reddit questions, like stock Reddit questions. But if you had to fight either a horse-sized duck or 100 duck-sized horses, what would you choose and why? And you guys can answer individually.
Yeah, 100 duck-sized horses, because I just don't see anything on a duck-sized horse being, even in bulk, being as dangerous as a bill of a duck that size.
Yeah. But I mean, they
kick them. I was a soccer player, you know, I could fuck them up pretty good.
Are they horses, or are they like those like little dinosaurs from Jurassic Park? Like those,
yeah, that's what I'm saying. That's why it would be hard.
But what are they going to do? They're horses. They don't have claws. They have hooves.
They bite the shit out of you.
they could bite you, but you know,
it'd just be annoying more than anything, you know.
It'd be like being bit by a little dog that can kick you at the same time, and there's 100 of them.
Yeah, but I don't think horses have canines like dogs do either.
Yeah, you know? That's true.
I would almost do the horse-sized duck, just because, I mean, in this theoretical situation, do I have a gun? Because, I mean, that would be...
No, it's with your bare hands.
With your bare hands, right?
So you're fucked either way.
Yeah.
Well, I guess
100, maybe 100. It would be a little quicker if you're with the big duck. You know, you got that going. It might be a little more tedious. You're going to die either way, probably.
Yeah. Well, I mean,
a lot of the answers that we've heard were definitely take on the horse-sized duck, because it's one thing to worry about instead of 100. And I imagine, you know, since ducks don't really have like arms, that you could get on its back and put it in some sort of headlock until it's down. But I mean, you know, depends on your surroundings, I suppose.
Yeah, we have to really do some research here. Figure this out. It would be nice to fucking, if you had to, be able to kick a tiny horse.
I'd rather see a tiny horse.
I would just capture them and sell them all on the internet. You could make a fucking
yeah,
make a killing on that shit. One of the other questions that Josh usually asks is, do you think a hot dog is a sandwich?
No.
Well, Webster's Dictionary actually defines a hot dog as a sandwich, which is pretty strange. Because I argued that it was a sandwich, and I was just like, man, come on. It's in the sandwich section on most fucking menus that you look at. So,
open face.
Yeah. So how did you get into like the restaurant business?
So pretty much as soon as I got a car, I left my house and I lived at this old punk rock venue called Creepy Crawl in St. Louis. I mean, I was still living at home, but like pretty much would get in my car, leave school, go to Creepy Crawl, come home at like 5 o'clock in the morning, do it all the same day, you know. I just really didn't have anywhere to go. And with touring, I could always work there and come back, and I always had a job, you know.
Yeah.
So I just kind of got into bartending as a a necessity because they needed it. You know, I started off as a bouncer. Mm-hmm. And then pretty much like I got really into bartending and I started taking it really seriously, and I started researching it more and learning the culture and the tradition. And you know, eventually, like, you do it long enough, you start getting into management and stuff like that. And really, it was just for me to enable myself to make more money and keep going, you know. I wanted to see how far I could take it. And then really, like, just kind of fell into like an equity kind of thing, and revived a business, and I don't know. It's been fun because my personality is behind it. I don't have to, like, I'm not one of those stuffy mixologist guys, like, but I can fucking make anything that they make. I just don't, you know, I think personality and affability is going to be way more valuable, especially after the cocktail bubble bursts and people won't give a fuck that you're a mixologist anymore. They just want to fucking drink, you know?
Yeah,
and
for sure.
It's starting to happen right now anyway, because, you know.
Well, you're more reliable customer base in terms of alcohol or alcoholics. And alcoholics, you know, they're not really picky when it comes to, you know, they're not there for you to make fucking some fancy martinis and bullshit like that. Like,
right.
I know when I was drinking, I was just like, I want the cheapest beer you have, and I'll probably have like 20 of them. You know what I mean?
Yeah. So. Yeah. I mean, at the same time, I drink a lot, but me and my lady both drink pretty much every day, but like we like good stuff, you know? And yeah. I mean, it's just one or two things. Like, I prefer.
Well, I would say at this point, you're more a connoisseur, you know?
Yeah. Well, I don't know. I don't feel like a connoisseur right now.
Yeah. The reason I ask is because, with everything that the steam I'm trying to build with this podcast and shit, like, eventually I want to be able to open my own like venue, I guess you could say.
Mm-hmm.
And just fucking, I don't even know the first thing about operating a business, owning a business, starting a business or anything like that, you know? Yeah. So,
I actually, like, I have a couple business plans, like old business plans I could show you, you know. It's really the biggest thing is getting that plan down. Figuring out the numbers, figuring out what you're doing,
yeah,
and then being able to talk about it in a comfortable way to where, you know, you can get people to pretty much hopefully give you money for something.
Yeah, for sure.
And it's a rough business, you know. A restaurant that runs really well, it's doing good. You're looking at maybe 15% profit after everything's said and done.
Mm-hmm.
And that's making sure that your P's and Q's are crossed. It's the rough... rough industry. You don't do it because you like it, or you don't do it for the money.
Yeah.
And then doing a venue, that's really rough too, because, you know, every day's a risk, you know?
Yeah, for sure. So what would you guys say would be like the, because, all right, I've asked this similar questions. I've asked, you know, from a second story window, and I was like, you know, what was the, like, one of the sketchiest venues you've ever played, or you know, like one of the weirdest places that you've ever played. And their answer was, when I talked to Derek Vascani, they were talking about the trailer show with them and Ion Dissonance. When they went to a show, it got canceled, and they all ended up following this dude into the middle of nowhere and playing in a trailer. So do you guys have any similar stories or anything like that? Like, or just strange, weird place that you've played, like a slaughterhouse or something?
Yeah, we played a lot of weird places. My memory's not near as good as Tony's, though. Drink a lot of beer on tour. Pulled some up. It was a daily routine for me. It was necessary. So I remember, like, what was there was that house in New Jersey that was right off the coast, and it was just freezing.
Oh, right. It was those fucking... So, yeah, it was like this crusty kid and his dad.
Sebastian Bach there, too, or something. Shit. Like
Sebastian Bach's daughter was there, yeah. So, there is these beach houses that, you know, they're just seasonal beach houses. Pretty much they're just giant boxes with a window on the side of it. And they, this dad and this kid pretty much, I mean, I guess they owned it, so whatever, but they kind of squatted there. And he would do house shows because they didn't have heat. And so they would do house shows because it kept the house warm for a couple days. And, yeah, we played with, I forget the band, but it was members from An Albatross. It was us, Sunday Nomine. If you never heard Sunday Nomine, too, you should check that out. There's a website called Nomine Faction. All the stuff that the singer does is on there. I'm in a group on there called Doomsday Device, and that's on there. But it's really cool for the music that you're into, that you're talking about. Those guys were pretty much fucking prime. They kind of took us out on our first tour, too, and they never hit the steam that they needed to get. But they're an awesome band. But we played there with them, and it was just this tiny room. I mean, the whole house is probably as big as the dining room that I'm sitting in right now. And I remember...
It was just one of the coldest places I've ever been in my life, just getting to the damn thing. And there's another place that was... We played in a huge barn, and right behind the barn was a trailer park. So as we begin to play, we're like, these people are going to fucking call the cops. There's no way. I mean, it's still loud. It was a metal, like a metal barn. And it was just a huge speaker amplifier. I mean, the cops came in while we're on stage and, you know, threatened to arrest us 10 minutes into the fucking gig, just like we planned. So that's always a bad venue.
Yeah, the fucked up thing about that, too, there was only two bands playing that night. And that first band was this, like, terrible, like, artsy, like, grind band. And they played
They played for a long time.
They played for, like, fucking an hour and a half.
And then we got on and... Immediately.
Yeah, and the coolest thing about it, though, is like there was like three kids that showed up, and they're like, "Oh, you're Tony, and you're Josh," and like, "Oh, like they knew the words to they knew the lyrics to the songs and all this stuff." And I think we were still selling CDRs at that time. I don't even think we were selling actual CDs yet.
Yeah.
And they just knew everything about us. And the cops came in. I was fucking heated. I'm yelling at the cop. The rest of the band's throwing shit in the trailer as fast as they can. Pretty much, we're selling merch as we're running to the fucking running to the van. Dude, these kids bought like $250 worth of shit. I remember that. And like, pretty much, like, I told the cop to go fuck off, and I ran around the building. We got in the van, we just took off. You know, for a while, I was like, "Fuck, we're gonna go to jail." My uncle lived in Houston too, so we'd always visit him. And it was like our first time we were in Houston, and I was just like, fuck, man, I'm going to end up in jail. I have to call my fucking great uncle to get us out. This is going to be fucking terrible, you know? But,
yeah. There is a lot of that shit. Stuff like that. Crappy venues, weird just places. You're like, what? I can't believe it. There was the place in Fort Wayne that it fit like three people other than the band. It was in a basement. The house was, you know, 150 years old. Remember that one?
So that's one of the most like beautiful things about that style of music, or like, I guess you could say like punk, or, you know, whatever, any like, I don't give a fuck, I'm going to put a show on anywhere kind of, you know, music. You can't do that with all types of music, you know?
Yeah. I actually thought our music, I thought the shows actually transferred a little bit better that way too. I mean, yeah. I felt, you know, I liked them a lot more. I remember in particular, we played, It was probably right after we left LA, and we were kind of living in Long Beach for like 2 or 3 weeks because we were bouncing in between tours, and there was no point to drive all the way back to St. Louis, all the way back up to St. Louis to just turn around and go back out. So we were living in Long Beach, and we were playing a couple shows just in Riverside and stuff like that. And sorry, work just texted me. And so we were playing with, like, we played with Intronaut, like, and it was like one of their first shows ever, or maybe not their first shows, but they just came out. And we were buddies with, like, the Scale of Summit kids, so we were hanging out with them, and like all the shows we're playing in Southern California are just awesome. You know, we play San Diego, Riverside, and we only had to drive like 2 hours. You know, we finally get up north, we go to Fresno, and this kid tries to steal the door money. I park the van behind him, and I sit in the car with him until he pays us. you remember that? It was like this little fucking, like,
I remember the spot. I don't remember the details of that. I remember the venue. I can see it. It was like a
living room. It was somebody's apartment. And then we went up to Sacramento, and that show was just shit. And then we went to, and then that's actually when we started hooking up. We played that art house show with Tara Malose. And
I actually have Jeff Worms is coming on next week.
Yeah, I love that dude.
he seems pretty interesting.
Yeah, but then after that, like, we went through, you know, the West Coast, and just shit fucking shows, and we were really down and out. And finally, we hit Spokane, I don't know how to say it, Spokane, Washington, and it was a really weird vibe. It was like just this hipster's house, and he was like, "Yeah, we're doing this house show, and then afterwards, we're gonna have a little dance party." And no one wanted to talk to us.
We love kids. They're all fucked up.
No one wanted to talk to us. Everyone was like kind of like off put. We didn't really know what to expect. And like, we were kind of like in the middle of a shit tour, and like morale was low. And the one person who talked to us was this really nice girl. And I was talking to her for a while and just being friendly. And she was just really sweet. And we start playing, and the whole basement just fills up. And like, we're on top of people. Like, we couldn't move. Josh is like playing guitar like this, and I'm feeling it because we just had like a shit week, and like, this show is fucking awesome. Like, people were fucking hanging onto the steps because they just couldn't fit in the basement, you know. It was fucking rad. And I fucking, like, there's a part where I lift my hand up and I fucking just punch down, and lo and behold, that one chick fucking like ate it. And I gave her a fucking black eye instantly. And I felt bad, but I was also really cheap, so all I did was give her free buttons.
That was the same show. There was a guy that was standing right in front of me, and he was eating mac and cheese. He was just sitting there eating right in front of me, and then he just dropped it all over my pedal board. And I'm like, motherfucker, this is a big deal. I had fucking, you know, mac and cheese, it's kind of short circuit. And he's like, I said I'm sorry, bro. This is all having a hard plan. Oh, fuck it.
Man, I would love to fucking do like a documentary or something and just fucking be able to like reenact those kind of moments and shit, you know. That would be fucking so dope. Just because like I said, like with this style of music and with like, you know, punk or, you know, other similar styles of music in the sense of like the people who listen to it, like, you're not going to get that story if, you know, you're not even gonna get close to that situation if it was like rap or, you know, some fucking like something other than what it is, you know. Fucking
yeah. There's something to be said for when the situation when you're performing almost becomes dangerous.
Yeah, for sure.
It brings out an energy in it and chaos.
Hey, girl. Say hi.
All right. Yeah, I guess we've been on for about an hour now. Do you guys have any links or anything like you'd like to put out or
go ahead, Josh. What's the band you're in now?
I forget what. I'm just playing with a local cover little deal. So
yeah, the like Americana like roots band that's really good.
Oh yeah. Yeah, it's Shoe Clerks. That's just some of our buddies here that we kinda noodle around every week. It's just pop rock sort of stuff.
Yeah.
Just fun. Nothing too crazy. That's the Shoe Clerks. You can see that on like Bandcamp or something like that.
Pretty much, people in St. Louis, I just started my improv group up it back again called Past Left Tiger. It's me, the guitar player from Fister, and the drummer from Not Waving But Drowning. Really, you probably just have to follow me on Facebook because we don't really plan anything. We just kind of play.
right on.
I'm playing in a group called Key Grip the 22nd at Atomic Cowboy. It's a free show. And then also, you can find anything Alan Smithy related on whoisalansmithy.bandcamp.com. And our record's up there. It's free to download. Everything's free. You know.
Right on.
We did our album release, and all it was a – it looked like a record, but it was just a really nice printed sheet with the album artwork and then just a download code. So I'm trying to keep our albums free and as much as I can.
And that's the way to do it, man.
Yeah.
Let's do the last question. Was there like ever, did you ever have like a aha moment, like a surreal moment with when it came to like Lie? Like, did you ever like perhaps see like a review about your band and just feel like, I don't know, like something special, you know what I mean? Like, was there ever a moment where you're like, we're kind of bigger than I thought we were, or, you know?
I know that just going into it with the nature of the music, I just figured, you know, we're starting to get reviews. I just figured it would just be 50-50, people hating it, some people liking it. So when we had overwhelmingly positive reviews, that was a surprise. And then, that really the whole thing, just as it kind of progressed, was kind of like, oh shit, this is actually working out. Oh, wow. You know?
Yeah.
So there are probably a lot of little ones like that. But, as far as – I was always surprised at the way it was received. But
for sure.
Yeah. For me, I think we were in Revolver or Kerrang, one of those, and it was a big deal because it was, like, a nice color picture and a nice article, and I was like, you know, like, I fucking – when I decide to do something, I kind of jump in all the way, and I was pretty – intense about it. So my whole family is like, Tony's giving up his life for this shit. It's crazy, whatever. And so like, I was like, we had that magazine. I was like, fuck yeah, you know. And I ran home and I was like, you know, Mom, like, look, like, this has some grit. Like, we're doing it. Like, this is fucking rad. And they just go, you really should just go back to college. And I was just like, fuck.
Yeah, for sure, man. I mean, even with... I mean, I'm not expecting anything like huge to come from this podcast or anything, but I definitely can relate in that aspect because you're like, no one really gives a fuck about podcasts. You know what I mean? Right. And if you're trying to tell somebody like, oh yeah, you know, I'm trying to like build a career on YouTube or something. It's like, it just gets fucking like chuckled off and there's like, oh yeah, you know, when are you going to get a real job and do something better with your life and blah, 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 blah. So, I mean, I can definitely relate with that kind of issue, but I guess we're gonna wrap it up now, guys. It's been fucking awesome talking to you, and thank you so much for stopping by and sharing what you shared with us.
Yeah, thanks for having us, man.
Yeah, thanks, man.
Cool.
All right, you guys have a great night.
Thank you. What's up, Louie? What's up, girl? You okay? She's getting lonely.
It's all good, man. You just go ahead and end the call.
See. All
right, be easy, brother.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so that was our interview with Lie By Mistake. You'll be able to catch that on YouTube. Sorry about the inconvenience at the beginning of the show. And a couple of viewers were on, and I was trying to run OBS on my computer, and it just does not run the same way as it runs on Josh's, so we had to start the entire show over. But I will post the beginning as well, even though I probably won't get very many, you know, likes or shares or anything like that, just because it was crap content. The content was there. It was just the quality of the call or whatever wasn't that great. My phone has actually died, so I can't see anyone's comments. And no one can call in because I'm using my phone to do the call-ins right now. So I guess I will wrap this one up. This will be a short one this week. But if you can, if you're still there, I don't know how many viewers we have right now. Please go to our YouTube and check out some of our past interviews and go ahead and subscribe to that, because we're expecting a lot of good stuff to come up. I don't want to give too much away because everything's not set in stone right now. But next week we definitely have Jeff Worms. He was in Terra Mellos, and he also was a touring guitarist for the Daughters. And like we were saying, he seems like a really awesome dude. It should definitely be an interesting one. And hopefully next week I'll have my co-hosts, and we'll be able to have some banter for you guys and a little more in-depth interviews. Other than that, I guess I kind of got to wait for Josh to come back on, if he's still listening, so to wrap everything up. But let's see here. You here? Okay. I guess we'll just wrap it up. So as always, thanks for watching. Catch us next Sunday. You know, give me all your love, likes, shares, follow our Instagram, follow our Facebook. Go ahead and check out our old videos on YouTube and give those a share. It's much appreciated. Check out our 666 follower giveaway that we're about to do, and go fuck yourself, San Diego.